What's the best way to start? Just start. That's the best way. So we have, every day is a retreat day here, isn't it? December 19th, 2015 here. Every day is a retreat day. I have great good news. Call this the Good News Channel, actually. That's probably what it should be named. It's walking together in the wow. It's very aptly descriptive. It's also the Good News Channel. What we get here is very, very good news. If you want great, great good news, this is where it's at, right here. Astonishingly great news. The news is so great that it elicits a wow reaction, so we're just not blindly consuming it like watching television like a zombie. No, we just have to let the fruit ripen, continue to work on allowing the fruit to ripen through the wow practice. This is the heart of it. Now, it's a convention, but we don't want to, we should at least adopt at least just one convention is really enough. But we don't want to try to outsmart ourselves and adopt no convention at all. This is a path of fools. The wow is our convention. Full stop in the wow. The wow is just this very vague, doesn't lead anywhere, does it? It just, it's a word that just ends in itself. Just wow. It's like a wisp, like a little outcropping on this sheer cliff. There's a little outcropping, and there you see this meditator just sitting there on the edge of this abyss, on this little tiny ledge. And this is actually a practice. You see sometimes this stylized meditation drawings of a meditator on the edge of some abyss, just sitting there. It's a very powerful practice. This symbolizes the wow. The wow is this internal, very vague, wispy convention. As a stance. This is our stance in relation to everything that's happening. As everything flattens out to the insights of truth, all we say is just wow to this. That's all we have to say to it. And this prevents us from getting hooked into quantification. And this is what I went through this whole morning. I went through this very intense clarification of the whole situation. And this resulted in a very powerful wow. And I recognized the importance of the wow. And so I would say the key to success is to adopt at least this one convention. Now, in other times and places, they had similar conventions to this. But we don't want to be tricky and say, well, let's try all sorts of different conventions. Now, they would have scoffed at us and say, what fools, what idiots. Just settle on one for your time and place and do that. We're not, just like they did. Now, in maybe in Zen circles or Chang Buddhism or whatever, if that's a word, I don't know. My mind is pretty much in the wow right now. In different traditions, etc., different places, it might have been like woo, like just woo. Same purpose, fills the same purpose as wow. But for us right now, wow fits the bill. And they would look at us and say, yeah, you're really smart. Well, not, they wouldn't say you're really smart, they say you're really wise. We look at them and say, you are really wise, because I'll tell you, there was tremendous wisdom in previous times and places here. They knew what they were doing, these great teachers, they knew what they were doing, they knew what they were about. And so I look back at them and say, wow. And they look at us and say, whoa. And all is great that way, see? It's all good that way. what happens is, when we get the key insights, which certainly do arise when we search for them and want to find them, it flattens out our belief in electromagnetism, essentially. The belief that light can be changed. It flattens it out, the entirety of it. It flattens it all out. Now, if our attention is on quantifying it, or here's an example. Let's say there's a drought and the rain comes, which it did last night and this morning. It's been raining here. It's very cold now. It drags the cold air to the end, back into the storm. Let's say the raindrops start falling. You say, oh, there's one there. And you start trying to quantify and describe and narrate how the wetness happens to everything. Okay, this raindrop hit that little leaf, and then that fell onto this other leaf. Wait, there's other raindrops over here, and they're hitting. And it, before you know it, your mind is just whirling in chaos, right? This is the trap. You don't want to fall into that trap. This is why we back away from key insights. We think we need to quantify. We think we need to have a story, a narrate to it. So the discipline is just to go into this, wow, it's raining. Wow, everything's getting wet. Wow. And refuse to do any quantification or narration of it. To sit on that ledge, overlooking the vastness. And just don't move from that ledge. Now, the ancients used a lot of physicality because they were very physical. Keep in mind that in the past, people died young, but they worked really hard. They were very physical. They walked. I mean, these people, they relied upon their physicality to get around. They hiked through the mountains. They, you know, they were very, very sturdy and strong and physical. So the idea of assuming a lotus posture on this cliff face, this little ledge, this had powerful resonance for them. Now, in our day and age, when we're most people sitting in an office all day and drive back and sitting on a sofa in front of the television, we don't relate to that as much at all. Maybe we're kind of wistful and nostalgic for that, but that's not happening right here, right now, okay? Very different. Very, very different. They lived very intense lives back then, because what, they lived to 40, 50 or something like that? What did Longchenpa, he passed away when he was, what, 56 or something like that? I mean, very active. They were active from early age, from the get-go. Their parents were active, their grandparents, their relatives, everyone. You're born into a very active clan of physical activity and intensity, and so they would challenge themselves in that way. We don't need to challenge ourselves in that way at all. We can just sit quietly, like here. We don't have to be on an actual cliff face, but we can. Here's another analogy. Like, I use sneezing as a very good analogy. If sneeze starts to build up and it seems like it's inevitable, you're going to sneeze, and you have to say, no, I am not going to sneeze, and have the intense will and determination, and this ends up dissipating. It ends up sort of like going backwards into the ground or out where it came from. It's just amazing. This is the intensity of discipline we need for the wow. You must stay in the wow. That's the only response we have to this insight, because the insight itself is flattening out our total attachment to electromagnetism, which is light pretending not to be light because we asked it to, not because it decided to on its own. It didn't say, hey, mind, I've decided I don't want to serve you anymore. I don't want to be what I am anymore. I am going to change what I am, whether you like it or not. That didn't happen. That did not happen. Nothing went rogue. Nothing's ever gone rogue, okay? Nothing in reality has ever gone rogue, contrary to dualistic explanations, which have no choice but to put that in there some way. Nothing's gone rogue. We asked the light, hey, we wanted to change. We want you to change. We want to change reality, light. So light had to pretend to not be light, which is what we call electromagnetism, which really doesn't even exist, actually. It's pretense. It's an appearance, it's a mere appearance. So all of the strategies of electromagnetism, and there are infinite strategies and cleverness, is there not, and smartness. Electromagnetism is all about smartness, how to prolong delay, how to keep delaying. It's all this smartness. We just sit in the wow and just say, wow. And allow it to just all be flattened out the way rain brings wetness to everything. And after the rain is over, everything is has been wetting down, right? Moisture's everywhere. It's in the ground now. Refuse to quantify. Refuse to take look at anything special that's happening in this flattening out. And all sorts of stuff will arise, and you'll find certain themes that arise more than others. That the heart of specialness in electromagnetism is, of course, replication of form, of supposed definition. And that will keep trying to pop up and say, hey, you know, this is important, this is special, I'm special, I'm special. I replicate form, I'm important, I have to define, light has to crystallize, be defined. Refuse to get engaged with that, either to say no to it or yes to it, just say stay in the wow and just don't pay attention to it. Disinterest. Insist on disinterest. There's a great mantra, insist on disinterest. Insist on disinterest. And again, be more intent on this than even breathing. This is more important. Guard this disinterest as if it's the all important. And again, if you want to feel that sense of intensity, when a sneeze is building up, and you in your mind you insist, if this cannot happen, if I sneeze, I'm going to die. And you take that, it's that important. And you'll find that your will can focus in very intently to the point where it becomes stronger than the sneeze, and the sneeze has to back away. It backs off. Have that sort of intensity, determination, that nothing is going to capture my interest. The only interest I have is just wow. That's it. I am zero with no circumference. I am zero with no circumference. Wow. Don't apply it to anything. It automatically flattens out. Delusion. All of it. See, if you try to minimize it by quantifying, say, okay, what are you doing? You think you're being helpful. I just want to be helpful. I want to see what you're doing. No, that's interfering. It's interference. Electromagnetism, the attitudes of electromagnetism, which is just extending this pretense, delaying the recognition of this pretense. It loves to interfere through claiming to help out. So let me help you quantify this, and you'll see how much you're doing. It always wants us to quantify, catalog. It'll nag us. And what it wants us to do is start quantifying and cataloging all the instances of being nagged, for instance, or being harassed or something, so that we get into cataloging, quantifying, all this stuff. Refuse to catalog. Refuse to quantify. Very important. I recognize this in my life. Just, wow. This is the game that's being played here. But do not try to apply the insights, the clarification to anything specifically. In this way, it will be applied to everything. Refuse to go into quantification. Stay in the wow, in this nondescript, kind of just a bare wisp of a concept that seems to just end in itself. Just stay with that. And yet, it still feels like a little ledge that you're on. You're not in the abyss. You're not in the abyss. There's a little ledge there. And these ancients, they would find caves in these cliffs, And those were very treasured. Or they'd make caves. I mean, they were very amazing. And they'd have these ladders, bamboo ladders or vine ladders. They'd scale up there and they'd bring provisions and they'd stay up there for, you know, months at a time in the cave, looking out over the vast spaciousness. And then sometimes they'd even build a little ledge just so they could sit out there right on the edge of it all. And they know I can't move. I can't move from here. If I move, I'm going to die. So I dare not move. They challenge themselves that way. Well, we're not challenging ourselves that way. But we're equally challenging ourselves. But not in such a physical endangerment way. Because we have so many stress endangerments here. It's enough. Don't single anything out. Don't get hooked into following some sort of narrative or pleading or someone says, hey, engage with me. What about us? What about we? What about us? No us. Just wow. Don't respond. Just stay in the wow. Just ignore it. Intense disinterest. Intense disinterest. Practice intense disinterest. Imagine yourself beyond this little ledge in this vast cliff overlooking huge, vast river gorge and spaciousness, and you're just determined to stay right there, because all of these thoughts are enticing you to step off that ledge and say, hey, over here, over here. What about over here? What about over here? There's only light, knowing light. That's all there is. There's nothing that needs to be said about it. There's nothing to quantify at all. We're a center, a zero centeredness without any circumference. All reality is a zero centeredness, center of zeroness with no circumference at all. Nothing to be quantified. Nothing to be overcome. Nothing to be realized. And because of our continuity issue, fear, pragmatism, is we do need to use this expedient of the wow. So this practice we're doing is very similar to the ancient practices that have throughout history that have been successful. It's just that we're doing it right here, right now. Full stop in the wow. And it will work. It will work. The insights are deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. Just like exercising and stretching and everything. This example, I use golf as an analogy to the spiritual path. It seems to fit pretty well. This morning, I discovered the pro move. I discovered what the pros do, actually. And I said, wow. And I just stopped. I said, okay, let me not overdo it. Last night I was working on timing. I was 1, 2, 3, backswing, then torque a little more, then the downswing. 1, 2, 3, which is important. But then I discovered the timing mechanism, and actually with the club, it's like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, like that. And all the fitness and the slimming down I've done, which I'm a very good weight this morning. It's enabled me to be more flexible and to torque the body more. And I discovered, I had been reading articles about this, but I actually discovered now what it is. It's like, wow. And it was so shocking. I just did it a few times. I realized this is it. And then I just stopped. I said, okay. But this is a wow thing. This is just, don't try to start quantifying. Well, how am I going to do now? It flattens out everything, so to speak. because everything is everything. It's like in golf, every part of your golf reflects through everything else, and all your habits are, it's like a gestalt. It's not all separated out from one from another. So when we're able to understand the pro move, and it's a power move, it changes everything. It changes everything, actually. That's like when we get a recognition of reality. It changes everything. It changes our whole attachment to electromagnetism. All of it. All of it. All of it. All of it. Don't quantify. Don't try to categorize. Now, what the pros do, the pro move, is hip rotation. The pros have extraordinarily a large amount of hip rotation and very fast. Like the fat Rory McIlroy has incredible. He's 5'8". I saw him at the U.S. Open at the Olympic Club in San Francisco, and he's a small little guy. I mean, he's 5'8", 150, 60 pounds. I don't know, but he hits the ball unbelievably far in the air, like 330 yards in the air, just unbelievable. Extraordinary watching him hit the golf ball. And they tested him out with high-speed video or something, and he has extremely fast hip rotation, even for pros. And the problem that amateurs have is they try to hit the ball with their shoulders and their arms and their hands. The pros corkscrew themselves and use the hips to trigger the uncorkscrewing, as it were. And they just relax their arms and their shoulders and their hands. They relax all that like a whip. And they use the core of their body, especially the hip turn, to release all the torque that they've stored. And then this descends to a very fast, powerful swing. So what I did was I used the one to turn my shoulders as far as possible. And then the two, I then turned my hips back as far as possible. Quick torque of the hips back, which really puts a lot of pressure on the spine and body. It does, but then a quick release of the hips, and then that causes the whole body to turn through very fast. And I haven't been able to do that. I mean, various injuries, it puts stress on the body. You have to be fit and flexible to do this, no question about it. But this really delivers a powerful, powerful swing. And I just said, wow. That's their secret, no question about it. Discovered it. It's a timing mechanism. You turn the hips last. You turn the shoulders first, and then on the two count, you do a quick torque of the hips back. You know, and then when you do that, it's like a rubber band. You stretch, and then it automatically wants to release. So it's almost like an automatic timing mechanism, and that's how they're able to get their swing so repetitive, is that hip turn, and then the release of the hips, just it's like a timing mechanism too. Really amazing. But I can feel it put stress on my back, no question about it. So I said, okay, you need to back up, you know, back away from it, don't overdo it, and keep stretching and strengthening the core, which is these golfers have very strong core. They work out all the time. They're in the gym all the time. Tiger Woods was an absolute fitness fanatic, strengthening his core, extremely strong core. He probably overdid it by strengthening his upper body too much. I think that brought out injuries. Tried to do too much. Should have just stayed with flexibility and core training. And explosiveness, like jump rope. I found out that you jog, that your muscles just kind of sluggish. There's no explosiveness in the muscle, but jump rope puts the quick twitch kind of reaction in your muscles. After jogging, I couldn't jump or do it. No explosiveness in my muscles at all. Amazing. Just noticing this stuff. So this is an analogy to the spiritual path. When you get the insight you realize it's a powerful, just like when you have a powerful golf swing, you say, ah, that's it. You feel it's obvious. The speed is way more. You just unleashed a really powerful swing. You just say, wow, that's what I'm looking for. You know it. Same thing with the insights, spiritual insights. You say, ah, that's what I'm looking for. Wow. I'll never be the same again. Now I see that the pro, we want to be spiritual pros. Absolutely. It's enough to be on the tour, so to speak, like a golfer is on the pro tour. He's a pro. You know, he may not win the tournaments, but it doesn't matter. He's a pro. I mean, everybody respects him. All golfers respect the pros. They're extraordinary. And so you may have a few at the top dogs who are winning all the tournaments. So fine. Those are the super superstars. That doesn't take anything away from the other pros. They're very, very, very good. Same thing in the spiritual path. We want to be spiritual pros. We may not be the top dogs, but we're in their company. We're in their company. We can hold our own. You know, they're more accomplished in little ways. That's fine. They're the top dogs. It doesn't take anything away from us at all. And respect goes to those who are spiritual pros, absolutely. Same way that like I say, just, you know, hackers, most golfers are just hackers. And they respect the pros. They're just like, oh, are you kidding me? You know, they're just they're freaks of nature. We don't understand. How do they do what they do? It's just quite astonishing. And same thing with spiritual pros. Most of us are just spiritual hackers stumbling along in the curb, and we look at them and say, how is that possible? What's their secret? What's this? Well, I would say this wow is the secret. And of course, the people would ask, like the Zen master, you know, what's your secret? He just goes, woo. And they go, what is this guy? they'd bark or something, you know. I mean, they had the different stuff depending on the style and the teacher, whatever. But they were not being frivolous. Actually, they were saying, "This is the secret. Just this faint wisp of a response to the flattening. It prevents us from getting pulled in. As soon as we get pulled into quantification, then the issue of chaos arises." Chaos is really like belief that there's something that's been lost or searched, or something to be found, but you can't find it. There's nothing to be found. Don't get pulled into chaos. I was looking at chaos this morning. I was able to look at it, and this is I looked at it in a different way. Let me slow down a little bit here. I don't want to go too fast here. There's a lot. I went over so much. If I just condense it all, it may be too much. But let us just say the attitude. Let us hypothetically say we're looking at chaos, the issue of chaos. Just be casual and nonchalant, like, and you're like a walking stick. You're kind of poking around here, looking there. It looks like you're looking for a golf ball. I lost a golf ball. Went over the bushes somewhere, deep grass, and you walk over and, you know, step here, step there, take your club and pick the grass up and sit here. Stay casual, don't be frantic. Hey, just looking for a golf ball, that's all. But of course, when you're looking at this issue of chaos, this is the bottom line threat of the ego. This is its ultimate threat. So when you're just casually looking at it, say, I see that, I see that, it's interesting, I see that, huh? Just maintain this sort of casual, nonchalant air about you. Not in a hurry. Notice something, but eventually you'll get the wow reaction, and just stop. Okay. Because just looking at it, like I did this morning, flattens out everything, all delusion, flattens all delusion out, because the central threat I saw through, the central threat I recognize is no threat at all. This has to flatten out all defenses, doesn't it? Egoic defenses, the entirety of it. So at that point, I must be very, very cautious and careful not to quantify or provide any narration at all. Just wow. What's your secret? Wow. They take a, some would take a stick and start beating the questioner, chase him down the street with a stick, a bamboo stick. What they're showing is, if any of those questions arise in your mind, are these, hey, you know, what about me? What about us? What about relationship? What about this? Just, you know, drive it off. Drive it off. Refuse to engage with that. This is what it's symbolically expressing in a physical way. They're much more physical then. People are very physical then. We use, what do you call it? Revisionism. Thinking the ways we are now, implying it to the past, and we completely missed the boat. Very different back then. Everybody was super physical. Not like today. We look back with horrors. Oh my gosh, that's such abuse. That's not today. No. People were tough back then. I've talked to people now who grew up and they said their parents used to beat the heck out of me. And they say, you know what? I didn't mind. I looked back. I said, it was great. It really made me the person I am today. It really helped me discipline. I said, no, I didn't really mind it. It was tough, but we were all tough. Today, if you hear that, everybody wants to, you know, lynch the person, crucifies it. Oh my God, this is the worst thing ever. Because we're all such pansies. We're all so frail. We're all so, you know, this is the way we are in this day and age. We're just like, oh my gosh, how horrible. Yeah, but not back then, no. So we use revisionism to make it seem like we're so great, we're advanced. No, we're not. No, we're not. We're not advanced. It's just we have a different style because of the economics of it. It's so easy. Just go into the grocery store, get your food, go back, watch television, get in your car. The people then they'd walk, you know, walk. Put whatever they got on their back, carry it to their house, start a fire. I mean, they were nonstop. Industrious and physically industrious. They shove one another, they punch one another, they hit one another, and nobody thought anything of it. They battled one another. Their combat was hand to hand. They loved it. They had all these martial arts and everything like that. This was how it was. We can't say that we're superior to them. And they can't say they're superior to us either. All right, so just let it go with that. Just into the stop in the wow. Most people are so frail now, it's extraordinary, especially the young people who've just grown up not doing anything except playing video games. I mean, at least I grew up tough. I mean, sure, I got punished and in various ways, and we went through, I mean, they don't even have physical education, all the calisthenics hardly anymore, it's elective. I mean, we, every weekend, we're taking hikes, we were physically tough, but not as much as our predecessors, no way, and you keep going back and back and back, it gets tougher and tougher and tougher and tougher and tougher. They'd go out and hunt tigers with a knife or something. I mean, there these. So the youth of today just abhors any nuance of toughness, but we still have to be tough, mentally tough. Okay, so we need to be mentally tough. Now, what electromagnetism is trying to do is automate delay. Automate delay. So they want it to be easy. So the whole thing is about easy delay. And this is what this generation, these generations have coming in. This is what they're after, easy delay. So they can say, well, we have a sense of ease too. They say, we're not attracted to reality. We have this easy delay. They're trying to get rid of the attractiveness of reality within them by working on easy delay. So they want to just be able to do nothing as far as no effort at all, and yet still delay and ignore reality, deny reality exists. Have all the quantification done automatically, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a different attitude. But we need not be intimidated by the past, the toughness of the past. We need not be intimidated by that. They did all sorts of austerities, right? But for them, that worked. That worked. They needed that. Otherwise, all their physicality would sweep them along. They needed to channel it in a certain direction. We don't have that much physicality, so it's not so important for us to do that. We don't want to become completely wilted, you know. So that's why I had to get back in some kind of shape just to be able to work, actually. But we don't make a fetish of it. We do want to be flexible. We don't want our consciousness on food so much. Here's an analogy. In this contemplation this morning, so into it. When you get into it, it's the most important thing in the world to you. And so no siren song of sex, drugs, rock and roll, food, you name it, calling to you, don't pay any attention to what's there. It doesn't even arise. Zero interest. This is how you can tell if you're really serious, you're doing serious contemplation. Is like this morning, 12 o'clock, I hadn't gotten up, haven't eaten anything. That no thought of food ever arose in my mind. Not even the faintest notion of food, eating and food. No thought of music, no thought of sex, no thought of drugs, no thought of going somewhere, no thought of doing something, no thoughts of any of that stuff even came into my mind in even the slightest bit, because I was intensely realizing the importance of escaping the hideous trap of the strategy of delay, the curiosity towards delay. And you know, I gotta do it, because the strategies keep hitting me. All sorts of wicked strategies hitting me. And the pressure just continues and gets worse and worse. These strategies are just vicious. So when it's that important, all thoughts of the body, doing what with the body, recede. They're not important. This is a mental thing. Full stop in the wow is a mental thing. It's a mental trap that we've fallen into. And so I have to be careful what I talk about. I'm still in the wow, so I don't want to, you know, I have to respect that. And no thoughts of relationship arise. No thoughts of us arise. No thoughts of specialness arise. No, none of those thoughts, special relationships, no. It's just staying in the wow, because I've seen through it. I saw through it. Wow. And of course, recognizing this extreme importance, this is the pro recognition. Just as this morning I recognized the pro swing, golf swing, I recognize it. Wow. This morning I recognized the pro insight about chaos. I recognized it. And so this is a huge wow, and I realized that wow, just as in the golf swing, I realized, wow, that's it, that's the power swing right there. Same thing with this insight, I realized this is the power insight. Changes everything, absolutely flattens everything. all delusion, flattens all delusion, takes away the threat. So I just went into the wow. So I'm not trying to tell you what that insight is right now, because there's too much wow still reverberating. I don't want to struggle. Once it cools down, I'll get back to it. Just like the pro swing. And once I'll stretch and work out and keep strengthening, and now I know what it is, so I can I'm aware I can get it back. Get back to it. So it's like that. When you get the great insights, you will recognize it. That's high swing speed. That's really powerful. Okay, good. Let me now just back off. Respect the wow. And then remain disengaged, detached, disinterested, intense disinterest with all of the attempts to say, oh, you're really flattening me out, or this. No, don't even engage with that. Say, I'm flattening everything out, and I'm not paying any attention to what in specific is being flattened out. No specifics. See, the wow is non-specific. Do not be pulled into any specifics. Remain in this non-specific, just wow, which is just like a symbol for non-specificness, and yet it allows us this little ledge, which pragmatically we have every right to do so. It doesn't get in our way. Do not specify what is being flattened out. Refuse to specify. Refuse to be interested. Refuse to sneeze in that way. I'm not going to do the specified sneeze, the sneeze of specificity. Don't do the sneeze of specificity. Repress that. Push it away. Do not do the sneeze of specificity. It's like after the storm, everything's wet, but it's cold. So stay warm. Stay warm. Stay in the wow. Don't get pulled out in the coldness of specificity. All these clouds are, you know, moving all over the place, and they keep changing, right? Don't get pulled into looking at the clouds and trying to specify and count the clouds and categorize the clouds, because next time you look, oh, it changed on me. Wait a minute. I thought, just realize that this is the storm will pass through. It will clear up, and next day you go outside and you look up, clear sky. Don't get caught up in counting clouds. Now, of course, you say, well, that's the way to being smart. Yes, it's only the electromagnetic pretense that is invested in smartness. We are not invested in smartness. Light knows light. That's all we need to know. Light knows light. There's no need for smartness. So always the electromagnetic defenses of delay, the attempt, the curiosity of extending delay always talks about smartness, how to get smarter. And we reject that. We say we're inherently all-knowing, because there's only light, and light knows light. So we refuse to get pulled into smartness, quantifying, categorizing, shuffling. Refuse to lose in this regard. Do not get caught up in the smartness. And of course, these defenses will try to entangle you. Absolutely they will. And when you'll get entangled a bit, then just back off. And back off and say, no, wow. Just say, when you say, oh, wow. Don't try to disentangle. Just say, wow. Oh, I'm getting caught up in smartness. Wow. And that centers you back in the wow reaction. So don't struggle with the struggle. This is what I'm saying. When you find yourself caught up in the struggle of smartness and quantifying and all this, just then, instead of saying, how do I get myself free, as in struggling to get free of it, just go straight, just say, wow. Oh, wow. There's an example. Wow. Okay. Back to no specifying. So it's an immediate shift, right, back to no specifying. And then you'll find that that line of specification just sort of melts away. But don't specify it's melting away. You don't care whether it melts away or does or doesn't melt away. It doesn't make any difference. You're not paying any attention to what is melting and not melting. You're not specifying. Your attention is not on what is getting wet, what is melting, what is evaporating. Trust in the insight. Trust in the path. The clarification you had is evaporating everything. All delusion is evaporating. When we specify, we just interfere with that. We're delaying again. When in abidance, the ego tries to get us out of abidance, old habits die hard, and no narrative. And then he says, "Well, you're kind of dumb. I'm. Then you can do this. Yeah, I'm absolutely perfectly dumb." So, or you can say, "Well, I'm neither dumb nor not dumb." You can either neither nor or the yes, I'm perfect. Agree with your adversary practice. And the ego tries to throw a negative at you. Wow, you're really stupid. Say, yes, I am. Thank you. I'm absolutely, perfectly stupid. Forever and forever and forever. I'm actually perfectly, eternally stupid. Or you can say, yes, I'm neither stupid nor not stupid. nor compoundment of stupid and not stupid, nor an uncompoundment of stupid and not stupid, a non-compoundment. And you might be saying, "Why, this sounds like the advice of the ancient teachers." Wow, that's really amazing, because we think that we've changed somehow, something, you know, that light is crystallized, and now in this day and age we think that we can't do this. Oh yes, we can. Nothing has changed. We put it in what resonates right here, right now, but it's, again, it's very similar. You just have these little techniques you use to pull your, to bring yourself right back. But we don't have to follow some lineage of, this is the way they did 1,000 years ago, so we have to do exactly the same. No. Not at all. That could run into problems, actually. The Holy Spirit just advises us right now. Just do it right here, right now, in the vernacular of the times, and you will be just as successful as the ancients were. It would be just as strange to have the ancients try to do it in this way than us to have it to do it in the way of the more ancient folks, all right? There's no need to. But certainly, the overall principles are the same, in that we use quick, little, powerful techniques to avoid specification, avoid getting pulled in out of abidance. Keep practicing these practices, and ultimately, we'll find that we're able to abide. We'll have the pro move. Just like I've been doing all this stretching, flexibility, dieting, ultimately, wow, there's the pro move. Now, provided I keep doing this, it's reasonable to say that the pro move will stay there. Just like, provided we keep doing the right spiritual practice, ultimately, abidance will be there for us. Interference here. One moment, please. So just keep practicing. That is the key. Just keep practicing. Spiritual flexibility like this, these techniques. One moment, I have to. Send this off and it'll be done with that. Okay, just easy, hey, no more. Provided that the message was sent. I don't know if it was. I closed it up too soon. I'll make sure that it's sent. Good. I got the message. Message sent. It's whatever. There's nothing to specify in reality. As far as rights go, the only right we have is freedom. That's it. We don't have any other right. We don't have a right to guilt. We don't have a right to this. We don't have a right to insist that others keep delaying. There's no such right. There's one right, which is freedom. That's the God-given right. We don't have any rights that God didn't give us. Nobody does. None of us do. The only right we have is freedom. Perfect freedom. The right to perfection. It's the only right we have. And it can never be taken away from us. But it can't be added on to either. We cannot expand our rights. We just have one right, which is the right to be perfect. Now, as far as intensity goes, here's a golf analogy. The best golfers, they're loose, they're relaxed, they don't tighten up, they don't grip too tightly, they don't. And it's the same. The best intensity comes when you're not too tightened up and too serious, overly serious. We're very intense here, but we also joke. We have humor. We keep the humor. Keep it light. This is what the pros do. Also, the pro golfers, you look at them. They're joking. They're talking. They're staying relaxed. They stay relaxed. The ones that are all ferociously tight, they end up tightening up too much and the wheels come off. So there's a happy zone. There's a happy zone there. In the zone. Stay in the zone. Bird. All the birds are coming by saying hello. Well, maybe we don't even greet the bird when we're intensely focused on this. We don't even say hello to the bird. Just so everything is melting down, evaporating, all my defenses, all offenses. I'm not trying to take a peek. Curiosity killed the cat. Always remember that. Curiosity kills the spiritual path. Stay in the wow. Don't look back and be curious. I wonder what is. You know, I think that's in the Bible. Is don't look back. This is an ancient spiritual admonition. Don't look back. Don't be curious about what is it that's evaporating? What is it that's being flattened? Because then that becomes overwhelming. Say, wait a minute, what's going first? Which was flattened first again? Now, you know, you'll try to put a narrative, a quantitative narrative upon it. So refuse to do that. These are our habits. So we have very bad habits, actually. Our habits are extremely bad. Quantification is an extraordinarily bad habit. Definition, extraordinarily bad habit. Belief in crystallization. It's kind of what we're looking like, okay, what is being decrystallized and how is it being done? It's process, belief in process. Extraordinarily bad habits. Hideous habits, actually. We have hideous habits. got to emphasize this, our habits are truly hideous. So be very strict with yourself. Don't look back. Don't try to assess, okay, what is decrystallizing? Because nothing was ever crystallized. It's just a mirage. And we will panic if we try to, we'll get thrown into chaos, trying to search for meaning there. Curiosity killed the cat. Kills the spirit momentum, spiritual momentum. Absolutely, it does. Doesn't matter. He said, well, I'd be real smart. I'd be able to impress the ego. Well, we're not here to impress the ego. Ego doesn't even exist. It only exists to the extent that we're trying to impress it. We're trying to, you know, extend delay. If we want to be impressive, we want to impress something, right? So, oh, I'm impressing something. Well, it's the ego. The ego will understand this. You know, it's something to be impressed by it. These bad habits, hideous habits. We have hideously bad habits. So those who don't want to be serious and succeed, they always say, no, I don't have really bad habits. They'll say, no. But those who really want to succeed, they realize, wow, these are hideous habits. And so I have to be very, very adamant about not falling into these habits. They're literally robbing me of peace and joy and everything that I really want. They're robbing me of it, these hideously bad habits. They're terrible thieves. Terrible knaves. So do not look back. Do not assess. Don't do any assessment. Just wow. That's your full assessment. Wow. So what's your assessment about the inside? Wow. That's it. No, nothing more. Don't get caught counting dewdrops. It's like you come out in the morning and say, wow, it's heavy dew this morning. Then you go back inside and say, wow, okay, heavy dew this morning. Don't get caught counting the dewdrops. Say, well, how many dewdrops are there on this leaf? And which dewdrop formed first? And which dewdrop was second? And which was third? And how much? See, you're caught up in specification, quantification, categorizing, all of these hideously bad habits of so-called smartness. And of course you say, yeah, well, if we're smart, we'll be able to take care of bodies better and be happier. Well, of course, again, bodies all are just an appearance, a projection, mental projection. They don't really have any needs at all. Ultimately, no. It's all made up. Totally made up. Don't fall for that. We have no need to have a body at all. No one has any such need. We don't have any right to have a body. The only right we have is freedom. Now, we can use freedom whichever way we want to, but we never lose the freedom at all. So we can't say that we have any needs. We do not. We don't need to express our freedom as a body. We're free to do so if we want to believe in this appearance. But we're also free not to do so. Equally. There's nothing to pick or choose about here whatsoever. So where are the smarts in freedom? There aren't any smarts, actually. Now, once you do the pro move, then you realize, what do you have to work on? This is how I'm feeling right now. Okay, what do I need to work on to strengthen that core? Well, I need to warm up better, for sure. Stretch out more. Warmer climate. It's quite cold here. That helps, too, because your body's much looser. And same with the spiritual insights. You say, okay, what do I need to do now to focus in on this and get better at it? Well, I certainly gave it a lot of time. See, just give it as much time as you can, and don't put yourself under time pressure. It's just pretty helpful. Saturday morning, I sleep in. I said, I'm just going to do everything I can. And when I'm finally done, I'll get up then. It's happened to be about 11:30, 30-ish. But not watching the clock. Just say, I'm still in the wow. I'm just going to stay here until I feel like I can now move around a little bit here. Remember, everything in this world is just expresses a curiosity to extend delay. There's no necessity to extending delay whatsoever, none. There's no right to extend delay either, no right whatsoever. There's the freedom to do so, there's also the freedom to not do so. It's not a right. If you say it's a right, then everything is a right. You cannot specify a right, you see, so don't get into specifics, like, well, this is a right or this is not a right. Go into neither nor, it's neither a right nor is it not a right. This is just practicing this freedomness that we are. Cannot be specified, cannot be defined. We cannot define what we are, so we need to practice non-definition. This is the flexibility I talk about, spiritual flexibility, the neither nor practice. Practice non-objectification. I'm neither zero nor not zero. I'm neither this nor that, nor am I a compound of this and that, nor am I a non-compound of this and that. So the mistake I made this morning in like the golf swing, I didn't warm up enough, so the back is hurting now. But now I know, hey, that swing is there. I need to stretch and warm up a lot more before I do that. In the same of the spiritual path, you realize, okay, now what do I need to do to get to this insight? Well, you have to be quite serious and focused on the wow and say, I'm willing to not specify. And to not look back and not be curious about the melting down, the evaporating, the flattening down of all defenses. And get into that willingness, do some practicing, get in that willingness, and then you'll find the depth of your insight will start to unfold. And you'll be able to look very directly. I was able to look at this issue of chaos very directly and say, well, I am neither, reality is neither chaotic nor non-chaotic. I am neither chaotic nor non-chaotic. There's neither chaos nor there's there not chaos. Neither nor, just neither nor it, very casually. reality is neither chaos nor is it non-chaos. Nor is it a combination of chaos and non-chaos, nor is it a non-combination of chaos and no chaos. So the way to get back into future practicing is to do the one you're doing now really well, and then the success stays with you. You realize, I can do this. Even the most intense insights, I can handle the wow. So this is all I'm doing now. I'm proving to myself I can handle that insight. And it relates to chaos, which is the ultimate threat. That's how the ego threatens us and keeps us cowering in fear, actually. And when, when we're able to just brush this aside in just a simple casual practice and say it's no threat whatsoever. I am neither chaos nor am I non-chaos. I can neither be defined nor can I not be not defined, nor can I be not defined. I neither can be defined nor can I be not defined. There's another way of putting it. I can neither be defined nor can I be non-defined. Not defined. Nor can I be a combination of definition and non-definition. Nor can I be a non-combination of definition and non-definition. And so obviously when the central threat has been greatly diminished, and this has ramifications. It's obviously extraordinary ramifications. And don't be curious about that. Let that... Let the wow, let the reverberation of this automatically do its thing. We don't have to specify. The lessening of fear, you know, it's like a massive evaporation of fear across the board. Just let it happen. No need to specify anything. Nothing in specific. Just as like you have the pro golf swing, the fear of not being able to hit the ball with power is gone. You say, I know I can power it out there. Oh, then the fear, oh, the golf course is too intimidating. I just, no, it's not any problem. We'll be able to, what about this hole? No, we'll be able to sock it on any hole. It doesn't matter. Be able to drive it out there. So it changes the overall paradigm. It changes everything. So with a great diminishment of fear, all our defenses, they're all based on fear. All our defenses are based on fear, which ultimately hinge on the fear of chaos, that the ego threatens us with chaos. It says, I'll define you as no definition, which means chaos. And I say, I'm neither definition nor am I non-definition. No non-definition. poof, there goes the threat. I can either be defined, nor can I be non-defined. Empty threat. Chaos is an empty threat. And so if that threat's empty of fear, the entire, all defenses will be emptied out of fear, ultimately. But how that evaporates, let the Holy Spirit deal with that. It's an organic thing. It'll happen. It happens automatically. Do not try to spin some narrative. Well, I had this insight, and then this fear evaporated over here, and this one over here, and that's what will entangle you and pull you down. Don't do it. Of course, most questions that people come ask a teacher is the ego saying, "Hey, ask them, you know, what happened before you just did. What happened there?" They want a narrative. They want a narrative because the ego knows that by keeping your mind on a narrative, you'll fail. You will fail. So the teacher should just say, "What happened? Wow, happened. What happened before? Wow, happened before. What happened after? Wow, happened after." I said, "Just wow. Just wow. That's all. That's all that happened. Just wow." Well, surely you must have been aware. No. Just wow. Wow is all there is to it. That's all that needs to be specified, is just wow. Do we specify how the sun's rays, warmth, evaporates all this moisture, all these dewdrops, and all the leaves? They're all gone now, right? Just a few minutes ago, I looked up, there's all these drops from the rain on this plant right now. Most of them are gone. Where'd they go? They evaporated. They evaporate. Are we going to give a narration, a specification of step-by-step process of evaporation? Stupid, right? But yet we think that, oh, this is smart. People say, oh, you're so smart. But only the ego says we're smart. Of course, we're being smartly delaying realization. If we want to say that's smart, fine. But we don't have any right to be smart. Neither a need nor a right to be smart. We have a right to be free, and freedom can express however it wants to express itself. So it can express in non-specification too. And if we're caught up in specifying and counting and narrating, it's easy to lose sight of our freedom, which is what the ego, of course, wants us to still not realize that we're free. So it wants us to feel that we have to delay. That it's delaying is a right, it's a need. There's no right to delay, there's no need to delay. Stressed out there. Interesting. But there's an overall understanding. Okay, so we get stressed out from spiritual practice too. But that's the point of it. We need to push ourselves. We need to dare to look within in the strategies of the ego and look at it. Is that really true? Am I really threatened by that? Can the ego really define me? And if it can, if I don't do what it says, that means it can define me in a terrible way, in a chaotic way. That's what the ego says. If you continue this way, I'll have to define you as chaos. I said, well, I'm neither chaos nor non-chaos. I can either be defined by chaos, nor can I be defined by non-chaos. I cannot be defined at all, neither a combination or a non-combination thereof. So that's the ego's threat. This threat reverberates throughout all our upbringing as children, especially as children. You get this, right? You remember, I'm sure, that if you don't do this, what's the underlying threat? Well, I define what you are. I created you. I created your body. If you don't do what I say, I'm going to change the definition of what you are. I'll make you ugly. You'll be an ugly, crippled person. Oh, no. Okay, I'll do what you say. Okay, now you're going to be a beautiful, wonderful, healthy person. Oh, thank you. Oh, God, I'm so relieved. This is, it's a witchery. You know, it's spell casting. It's using fear of definition, that the idea is that somehow what we are has been defined, and the one who did the defining can change the definition if we don't do what they tell us to do, what they want us to do. This is conditioning. This is the insidious conditioning that we've all been put through here. I certainly was put through it very severely. And I realized that we all have it to some extent. Underlies this deep threat. Oh my gosh, if I don't do the right thing, I'll end up with a leper. I'll end up sick. I'll end up deformed. I'll end up cancer. I'll do that, you know. I'll be, something will define me. The ego will redefine me. Something will redefine me in a negative way. So we live in fear. You know, nothing can neither define me nor not define me. No one can offer a definition of me, nor a non-definition of what I am, nor a combination of definition and non-definition, nor a non-combination of definition and non-definition. I remain as simply I am, the isness. Beyond all beyondness. Neither beyond nor not beyond. So the more we practice this neither nor, the closer we can get to looking at this fear of the ego defining us as chaos, and recognizing it that's an empty threat, which ultimately we have to see that's an empty threat. Now, most of us are too frightened to do that, and so we try to make a deal with the ego. It says, ego, let me go this far. I'll promise not to look at chaos, but just define me as a nice, beautiful person, happy person, okay? And the ego says, sure, no problem. But it keeps complete control over you. You're giving yourself complete control over your life to the ego, really. So you cannot make any deals with the ego like that. Or if you do, you just say, just wow, and then go further. Because all is 100% pure light. There's only 100% pure light. That's all there is. How could there be sickness? How could there be deformity? How could there anything defined that can't be? You cannot define reality as anything other than 100% pure light. 24-hour-a-day light. Never-ending light. Never compromised, never corrupted, never distorted, never changed light. 100% pure light. That's all there is. All there is doesn't have any need for a definition nor a non-definition. Neither a definition nor an absence of definition. I'm neither a definition nor am I an absence of a definition. Neither a combination or a non-combination of definition or absence of definition. Keep practicing in this way. This is a power practice. So again, the neither nor is like spiritual flexibility training, non-objectification training. And it did lead to this insight with chaos. I was able to see it and put it, flip the script and put it in the right perspective, which then results in this intense wow. Absolutely does. Just as all the strength and flexibility exercise I've been doing has led to me understanding the power move in golf. So just keep on keeping on like that. Be determined. Don't make a deal with the ego. You don't need to make any deals. This is what the great teachers help us with, reassure us. We don't need to make any deals with the ego. We don't need to make any deals with definition. We have no need whatsoever to make any deals with definition. But we pragmatically, on our own terms, we allow the wow. Just wow. That's temporary. We understand that. Temporary. It's a way of helping us out here. Just wow. That's all. That's convention. We agree upon this convention here. Walking together in the wow. So you know all this flattening's going on. Just let it keep going. Don't interfere. It's like someone's driving this bulldozer, flattening everything. Or just let the driver drive it. It's happening by itself. Don't interfere and say, "Hey, let me supervise this." No. Stay out of the way. The insight, the light of the insight, the truth of the insight itself is doing the job. Recognition is doing the job. Don't be curious. Don't be curious. Don't be curious. Don't be curious. And you know if you're kind of good at that. Like if I get like a wound or something, I just at first I pay basically no attention to it, but if it needs to get cleaned up, all right, you know, clean it up, dress it, bandage or something, and I just forget about it. Don't even think about it. Don't even look about it. Don't even look at it. It's not like I'm peeking every day, all the time. How's it doing now? How's it doing now? How's it doing now? Just say no. It's gonna heal up. Not worried about it. So this wound of electromagnetism is going to heal up. It's not really a wound, it's an imaginary, pretend wound. But that pretense is going to evaporate. It has no choice but to evaporate. Our freedom evaporates because we're still perfectly free. We realize we don't have any rights except freedom, that's it. So we're asserting this right as if this delay is a right. There's no right to it. It's just our freedom, curiosity. We're curious, so we want to continue with this delay. Well, that's our freedom, the right of freedom. And if we're not so curious, we're curious how to end delay, that's our right of freedom too. Everything is all right. What I have this morning? I had to eat something. I started. I put a banana in a Nutribullet container, plastic glass, and then I poured in a whole bunch of frozen blueberries, strawberries, and mango chunks. And then I poured for liquid. I poured in a strawberry banana protein smoothie, Old Walla strawberry banana smoothie. protein drink. Then blended it all up in the NutriBullet, and that's my breakfast and lunch right there. I drank a little bit of it. I'll eat something more. Yeah, I'm not going to try to starve myself, try to keep myself strong, which I'm feeling pretty strong. But the same hand, stay on top of the situation. Stay on top of your situation. You got to do some stretching. Stay on top of it. Don't let it lapse right now. We don't want to lapse right now. I'm not going to get into what's coming. I've got other videos I've done that. The troubles are coming. Of course, the ego is trying to intimidate us, for sure. What it calls blessing, bless us. So we don't want to lapse right now. Don't want to lapse. Or if we have lapsed, just say, wow, I've lapsed. Wow. Just the recognition of it produces a wow, because you realize you're not going to lapse any longer. Once you realize that, that right there is the turnaround. Wow. Because you say, I don't want to lapse. What am I doing? And then you start getting back into it. So I'd say stay on top of it right now. Commitment to stay on top of it. I know it's difficult to commit very much in advance. So I try to take it. For me, it's just through the new year. Through the new year here, I'm going to stay disciplined through the new year. Have to. Have good habits and make sure you stick with the good habits. And then, we'll see after the new year. I don't want to make too much of a long-term commitment, because then sometimes you think, oh, it's too much, I can't do it, then you fail. But certainly, through the new year here, into the new year, keep the good habits going. Stay on top of everything, stay on top of the situation, and we'll see where we are at that point. See how we feel. But by all means, don't lapse today. Don't allow lapsing to come into your day today. That should be a determination in your mind. I won't lapse today. I'm not going to go too far in the future other days, but today I'm not going to lapse. I'm going to stay with it today. And the stakes are super high right now. Super, super, super high stakes. So by all means, do not lapse right now. There's some in the world who are serious. Anandamayi, one of the greatest teachers ever been in this world. She met so many people came to her during 86 years of being here. Truly large numbers, in the millions and millions and millions. And she did say that out of everyone that came to her, very few came to her for truth. Very few. But she qualified and said, but there were some. There were some. It's a small percentage, but there were some that did. Same situation is here now, exactly the same. There are very few, but there are some. There are some. So those are the ones that we are here encouraging, and we're trying to be one of those as well. And you have to be serious. You stay disciplined. Stay on top of the good habits and insist on it. And don't lapse. Don't lapse today. Don't lapse today. It's very doable. Very, very doable. The threats can be seen as empty. Absolutely, liberation is doable. Most want to appear to be smarter. So they ask for something that'll make them look smarter in the eyes of their friends and family. To the friends, say, "Oh, you're really smart." And they think, "Yes, yes, I'm smart at delaying. You know, this is what most of us are after, is impressing the ego, really." So few really, really want liberation to the extent they're willing to do just wow, that's it. Full stop in the wow. So, I say the ego's threats are empty. So you absolutely can be liberated. The core threat is absolutely empty. Totally without merit. Absolutely we can be liberated now. Absolutely we can. And we will. We will. Just have to not lapse today. Don't lapse. Just keep plodding along, keep the good habits going, keep them rolling. It's really nice. What I'm finding is, it's good to have a few good habits, even though superficial as they may be. So at least you feel you're able to keep your good habits going. It's something you can look to. I look at people that are in a very negative spiral. I used to ask them, "What good habits do you have?" And they say, "I don't know. I don't think I have any. I don't know." They're unaware. This is bad. This is how we get in a negative spiral. Like for me, I can say, "Well, look, I'm doing a great job with my diet, I'm doing a great job with my weight loss, I'm doing a great job with flexibility, great job with cardio, great job with working on videos, great job." So I have all these good habits I can point to, and I'm saying, well, I got lots of good habits. Now, it doesn't, you know, they can be fairly superficial. I don't watch television. You go on and on with me. Don't listen to the radio. Don't pay any attention to the news. On and on and on and on and on. So many good habits. But I've worked at them consciously, trying to make good habits. So that way you stay, have a positive. It's hard to get in despair when you have so many good habits. Just say, hey, I just got a lot of good habits. I can keep doing these. I can keep doing these. And so I'm not going to get all negative and down on myself thinking I'm going to fail. No. But if we don't, are not aware of any good habits, it's easy to get in this failure syndrome. Really bad. So even superficial good habits, just start some. If you don't have any, I'm not going to have any more sweets. I'm knocking out the sweets. Every day you realize, hey, I didn't have sweets. I knocked out the sweets or whatever it may be. Or I did a little stretching. Every day I'm stretching. Every day I'm taking a brisk walk. Every day I'm watching these videos. There's a good habit right there. Very good habit, actually. For me, I tape just about every day. I'm keeping that habit going. See, it's very good. Full stop on the wow. I'm practicing that wow. Practicing the neither nor. Or the yes, I am absolutely, immaculately this. I can, I will, I already am. Continuity fear. I don't have a body problem. I have a continuity problem. Body problem doesn't exist. It has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me, because only the vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem. I don't have a health problem. I don't have a health problem. I don't have a health problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a health problem. Don't have an existential problem. I have a continuity problem. A continuity practice is very powerful. Or today you say, I didn't listen to any music. I didn't get pulled into music. Great. Big plus. That's a tough one for me. So we all have these tough ones. Maybe for some people, I didn't overeat today. food thing is a problem. Once you get into food consciousness, and the world is obsessed with it right now, it's very difficult to not overeat, actually. But when, once you break that, get a good habit, it's like my mind is, it's not even on food. People say, what do you have? You having dinner? I say, I don't know. I'm not even thinking about food. I don't know if I will. Maybe. I said, maybe. I don't know. And then I just go right back to what I'm doing. And eventually I might get up and say, is there something I can eat? And I look and go in the kitchen. Nothing really I can eat. And then I just say, forget it. And finally, later, I'll just say, okay, maybe I'll just eat something. Give me some cheese, a piece of bread and some cheese. That's enough. Maybe I'll do that this morning. I don't know. I'll have something. So it's just not on your mind. It's not on your mind so much. And when it is on your mind, have some fun with it and laugh about it. And say, yeah, maybe I'll have a kale smoothie or something. Just something. chia seeds and kale. I don't know. What's the newest superfood? I'm sure they've come with a whole bunch of new ones recently. They're always digging up something somewhere, aren't they? In some jungle. Yeah, the indigenous people here have been living on this stuff for so long. They got no tooth decay. I mean, look at this. It's unbelievable. And on and on and on. And then it gets sold through some exclusive dealership. Then a multi-level springs up around it. You know, it goes, noni berries or something. Noni fruit. This fruit cures all cancer. Yeah, have fun with it. Have fun. Take it lightheartedly. As I had organic chocolate cookies this morning. the packaging now is hilarious. Everything's organic. Organic, made with organic wheat flour and organic cane sugar and organic blueberries and organic this and organic that. This is organic chocolate cookie. Have as many as you like. It's okay. It's all ingredients are organic. Organic cane sugar. Organic cola. Here's an organic cola. Organic caffeine. These coffee berries were grown with the utmost love and care in an organic, sustainable way. So, and the organic cane sugar. So this is like a super duper organic cola energy drink here. So drink as much as you want. It's all okay now. Electromagnetic marketing. That's all that it is. I will look back at electromagnetism and say, wow, thanks. And that was a lot of creativity, but I think that's enough of that. The fourth dimensionals, I say, well, there's so much to quantify. What are you talking about? We've got a whole universe to study and quantify. By gosh, we can keep building more and more greater supercomputers, and there's no end to the quantification we can do. Holy cow, we can delay indefinitely here. We're never going to leave this realm, or we're never going to realize it never existed. You don't want to go down that path. This is the problem right now in the world, one of the problems, and we don't want to go down that path. And the world's being circling the drain right now. We go down the tubes, down that path, as that drain leads to. So much to catalog. We've got to catalog all the stars in the universe and all the planets in the universe and all the activity in the universe. Got to catalog it all. My gosh, we could be working at this forever. And all the astrological influences. My gosh, well, there's no end to the quantification and strategy and cataloging and dynamics and process. Oh boy, we'll be studying this. It'll never end. And ceaselessly, this is the dream of delay. This is the dream of delay. It is the fourth, you know, that's opening the computers and all this is opening the, it's the drain. We're circling the drain. Go down the tubes. And we're as deluded as the day is long. There isn't any universe. Never has been. There are never any universes, actually. God is not the architect of universes. Universes don't exist, never existed. There's only freedom. Only if freedom exists. Nothing is crystallized. We can dream, imagine, desire as many universes as we want. But they're not really universes at all. They're just dream apparitions, self-released in the now. They arise as self-released. Everything is self-released. Everything is spontaneous. Never loses the spontaneity of its innate release. There's nothing crystallized. There's nothing happening at all. Nothing's ever happened. Nothing ever will happen. Yeah, and even chaos can't happen, can it? Even chaos is self-released in the now. All chaos self-released in the now. All non-chaos self-released in the now. If this sounds like Longchenpa, of course, he's a great help, for sure. These teachers are vastly helpful. And keep in mind, the ancients, they had the help from all sorts of teachers beyond the grave, too. Why should we not also? Nothing has changed in that regard. Not all the help came through incarnate beings at all. A lot of it was those who are not incarnated, not here in the body. They helped out vastly. So we're continuing that. That tradition doesn't end. Absolutely not. Still very strong here. I insisted upon it. It was dying out. I said, no, I will not allow this to die out. No way. All of those of you who have realized your liberation from delusion. Help out right here, right now. Can't take this time off. Don't take this. No, you got to help out right here, right now. Absolutely. Just because nobody's asking, we said, well, I'm asking. They're not asking because they're enthralled by modern technology, is why. And the possibilities of delay. They say, hey, wait a minute, maybe we can extend delay forever, and then I don't have to worry about this continuity issue. Maybe this is the easy way. Maybe I can automate it. And so they're curious. They're intrigued. They're curious about delay. So they're not asking. That doesn't mean that they won't ask at some point. Of course they will. So let's keep the ball rolling here. Is there a fire going to happen somewhere? In our future, maybe? Let's make sure that we stay fired up about being liberated from the egoic threat, electromagnetic threat, the empty threat. Let's make sure we stay fired up about that. Co-opt the fire. Yeah, absolutely co-opt it. There will be a diversion, just like yesterday, that black car, 666 car, made sudden, unexpected move. Very slippery, clever move. It's like, wow, okay, this is what will happen in the world. It's these egoic tech people, those who are fanatically curious about delay, devoted to delay, there's going to be a very tricky move coming up in this world. Very tricky move. Sudden. Unexpected. Like, we're waiting, thinking things are going to continue on the way that they were used to continue on. No, they're going to make a sudden, tricky move. There may be quite a few sudden, tricky moves take place. So that's why we don't let our practice lapse, even though there's a fire truck out there. I'm not going to get up and say, well, what was that fire truck? You know, if you're a kid, the kid would jump up and start running, oh, fire truck. But, you know, we're more disciplined than that. If there's a house burning, you know, let them take care of it. Let the firemen take care of it. It's very difficult to be a fireman here now. It's super difficult. Basically, what you have to do is you have to make life very, very easy for those who are already firemen. That's the only way to get a job. You have to be willing to sacrifice tremendous amount of time, energy, money, everything to make their lives very, very cushy. And if you're willing to do that, then you can get in. If you're not, you can't get in. It's a racket. Very much a racket. But it's like a pyramid scheme. I mean, and the ones that are sacrificing to make life easy for their higher ups, they figure, well, I'll do the same. When I get higher up, then I can, you know, the ones that want to come in, they'll make it easy for me. Pretty amazing. It's not all about talent and skill and know-how and all that stuff. No, it's not. It's not even about who you know, either. You could know, you know, the chief, and it wouldn't matter. The politics of it is that you have to take care of the ones above you, absolutely. Oh. You can say the whole world's a pyramid scheme. The universe is a pyramid scheme. They try to set it right. And, you know, drop out of that nonsense. Full stop in the wow. Don't worry how it all evaporates, disappears. Don't have to have any narrative. Neither a narrative nor a non-narrative. Keep in mind, in order to have a non-narrative, we attempted to have a narrative. This is to know what do we not need to say? Well, you know, we go. So if I have a non-narrative about it, I've got to make sure that it's not the narrative. So it's a dualistic bear trap there. So neither a narrative nor a non-narrative. Now, if something doesn't want to come out, don't force it. Don't struggle with it. There's a reason for it. There's a reason. So, just say, okay, I don't want to get into that right now. That's fine. I've already gotten into it in the last several videos, you know, so that's fine. It's okay. We're focused on the wow here. And doing it. It's like exercise. You got to do it. Don't watch someone do it. You do it. You can do watch first and then do it, but you got to do it. Don't do it. There's no results. I know there's so many people that just expect they're going to buy it in a drugstore. You know, no. Buy the wow in a drugstore. No, you won't. No, you cannot. A wow is not oblivion. Wow is intense, focused awareness in a full context. It's not some drug you take that just knocks you into oblivion. Used to be that firemen they only would put out fires in the house, in those houses that had donated to them. That's a nice racket there, isn't it? Absolutely. And people still today, they say, oh my God, I hope the firemen will come to our house if we have a fire. They're still very nervous about the older people. Will they come? Will they come if I call them? I don't know. Maybe they don't like me. You know, they're nervous about it. That's how it used to be. And we tried to not have it that way anymore. But there's still all sorts of perks that are happening and going on. So kind of nice ambient noise right now. Dog barking over there. Fire truck over there. Very nice. Nice white noise. Helps the wow. It's like there's a fire. Let the firemen put it out. Don't be there narrating and quantifying it and say, well, what water put out what this? Just let them do their job and then later come back and the fire's all put out. It's the same thing. Let the recognition, the light of recognition, do its job. It'll evaporate the continuity fear. Don't count the clouds. The sky will clear. The evaporation of the clouds is happening. There you go. The truck's on its way now. And now when we hear, we can hear the chimes. We couldn't hear them before, could we? They were there, they were still chiming. We couldn't hear it because of the fire truck. So truth is still true. We're working so intensely on delay and ignoring it that we wonder, is it still there? Is it still there? Ah, well, yeah, of course it is. It's only there. Light knowing light. Light knowing light. Oh, it's all pure light, and the light is not doing anything in terms of. And here's something important. I've gone over before. I don't know how clear I can be about it. Or maybe we'll see. Maybe I won't get into it. It that's a whole nother big issue, big area to look at. See, this is the genius of the path. You have to catch yourself. Do you really want to look at that, or is the wow still too so strong? Say, let me just. I'm still catching my breath here. It's like you're walking along a trail and you see a hill here and you run up the hill for fun, run back down. Oh yeah, my breath is starting to, a cough is starting to rise. That means the wow is very severe. Don't try to do anymore. You go run up a hill, run back down, you walk along the path some more, run up another hill, run back down. At some point, you see another hill and you say, oh, maybe I want to run up that hill. And they say, let me catch my breath here. Yeah. It's like that. We're very eager, but don't be overly eager. When I suddenly lose my breath and all these coughs starts to rise, that means the wow is too strong. I need to stop. And it's right on the verge of that right now. That means we've done enough in terms of insight for this video. We've pushed far enough. So we push to the edge, but then that's enough. And now we'll just cool down. We'll cool down. We've almost got, what do we got? Almost two hours here already. That's a good exercise time. Just like too much exercise has diminishing returns. Too much push has diminishing returns. We don't want to go too much. That's why, again, caffeine is very dangerous on the path. You can't really have a path. Because you don't know how much is too much. You push right through it. But right here, I can tell. I'm getting the signs that this is enough. Same thing with caffeine and exercise. One of the great fatigue busters is caffeine, or what's that, guarana, or cocaine, or all the various things that people use. There's the stimulus that it cuts the awareness of fatigue and sore muscles and all this stuff. And so you can go. But you can over-exercise, and then later on you pay a severe price. For a while it seems like, wow, I did all this stuff and I'm not feeling it. I must be in super shape. This is great. But then later on, then the collapse happens, and you say, oh my gosh. And then what do? Go back to more caffeine to push through that. And so it becomes a vicious circle. Very, very addictive, caffeine. Very subtly, super addictive. And it leads to ruination. It really does. Been there and done that. Understand the whole cycle, how it all works. So you go way faster if you're naturally aware of how much is too much, and then you say, oh, you know what? Time to back off. And then you keep the momentum going. You don't collapse. The wheels don't come off. And then later on, you're able to go at it again, consistently go at it with intensely, and then back off. When you know when to back off, this maximizes your speed. Now, people with caffeine habits, well, okay, if you can't break the habit, then just do what you normally do. Don't push it. Okay, you can do that. Say, don't take extra caffeine or go into energy drinks or something. Just use your normal cup of coffee or whatever it is, and then don't do any more. You know, do it like that. That can be seen as a good habit. Because you basically, your body adjusts pretty much, right? To it. Just don't overdo it. Whatever you're doing, don't overdo it. And then maybe some point you can get off caffeine altogether. I know it's very difficult. Most people, it's severe addiction. They can't get off it. Terrible headaches, terrible troubles, and they go back to it. It's like cigarettes. I mean, people talk about how difficult it is to stop cigarettes. It may be more difficult to stop coffee. Caffeine addiction, very difficult. I was able to do it, but wasn't easy and great. You know, it comes back on you when you feel real tired. You say, oh, I just gotta have some. I hate this feeling of being tired. Oh, I know how to get rid of it. You know, it's like, but then you realize that to pay the price later on, then you want more, and it's insidious. So you just have to say no, not even one exception. This is the problem with any addiction. You can't make an exception. It pulls you right back. That's what they say, Alcoholics Anonymous. You can't take that first drink. As soon as you take that first drink, you know, you have backslid. Because it provides this boost, and you feel, oh, psychologically, hey, that worked really well, and I can manage it this time. Last time I went overdid it, but I can manage it this time. But no, because then the collapse will come, and then you need more, and ultimately need more and more and more. Same old road with addiction. I know addiction is a terrible struggle, but we have the capacity to overcome it. Just this wow practice overcomes this. Because we know how important it is. We have to succeed. Therefore, we must do what brings success. We must be disciplined. We cannot mess this up. Cannot mess it up. Must keep our good habits going. So, whatever bad habits we have, just have the good habit of making sure they don't get worse, which in itself is difficult. Like alcohol is very difficult. Most people, they eventually it gets them. But some people, they can discipline it. But if you do that, make sure you stay on top of it and don't mess up. Some people say, well, I just have one beer at dinner or whatever, something. Okay, well, make sure that's all you do. Don't do any more. And then take pride in a good habit. Say, no, I'm absolutely not going to make any exception whatsoever. But a lot of that is just trying to divert your will off to some superficial bad habit instead of tackling these hideously bad habits of quantification, of categorization, of definition, of specification. All these are hideous bad habits, and so that people don't want to tackle those. So they say, well, I'll have an addiction like alcohol, and I'll work on that instead. they avoid, you know, work. They think that's good enough. No, it's not good enough. It's really a compromise attempt. Say, well, I don't want to really acknowledge I have these hideously bad habits. But no, this is what we have to get at, these hideously bad habits of, you know, messing up our spiritual path, obstructing our spiritual path, going back into curiosity about delay. Those are hideously bad habits. Notoriously terrible. Notoriously nasty habits. So these are the habits that we need to tackle. So, you know, the body thing, like a traditional spiritual path, it starts out with physical discipline in the past because, you know, right physical habits. And once those good habits are there, then you go and you tackle other habits and good habits. And so your attention can ultimately get onto these terrible habits that we have. There's the path of yoga. It starts out like, you know, there's sequentially you have more and more discipline, more and more self-discipline, more and more discipline, more and more good habits, so that you can get to these terrible habits and the necessary discipline on these terrible habits. But yoga is not an end in itself. I mean, like hatha yoga is not an end in itself. I mean, once you got the physical body discipline and you're not eating, taking stimulants, and you're not taking drugs, and all, you know, your appetites are under control and all these things, good, that's a nice base. But then you have to still have to tackle these, you know, hideous habits. Absolutely. You can't just say, well, okay, look how good I have these good physical habits, so that's good enough. It is not good enough. This is the problem with the culture nowadays, is this physical culture taking it as an end in itself. It's not an end in itself. This hideous habit of thinking we need to be smart, thinking we need electromagnetic universe, thinking we need a universe, thinking we need this, and believing we have needs, believing we have to, that light is crystallized. These are terrible, terrible habits. Those are the ones that have to be broken. But we need to have good physical habits. We can't be, you know, a severe alcoholic and, you know, get after this stuff. Holy Spirit told me, advise me, don't overdo it with the nutrition, don't overdo it this, is that you'll slow down too much. Just and so I said, yeah, okay. And just stay moderate in this. Don't get sidetracked by trying to be too sophisticated in this way or that way. Don't be overly sophisticated. Habits, or good habits. Buddhism emphasizes this, the middle way of our habits. In other words, don't become a yoga master of hatha yoga, bending this way, can hold this pose for so long and bending this way. Yeah, just be basically flexible, stay flexible, or stay limber, stay flexible. keep your weight down, right? Don't have, just stay moderate. Don't be obsessed by any of this, and put your effort on these terrible habits we have, these horrible habits that we have. Put your effort there, and not into some trance condition where we're just not into all these different mental states. We're not really after various mental states. As opposed to what, right? We're looking for the non-dual truth about it, about reality, is the absolute freedom, non-definitional freedom, and that light never crystallizes. It's not like, say, well, I can reach a non-crystallized state. What is that? That's duality. Nothing has ever crystallized. This is the realization we're after. That's a far different cry than a trance state. That's just a, you know, maybe it's just like I can crystallize. Maybe mental states are just like attempt to crystallize light. See, I can crystallize it this way and hold it this way, and that's a good crystallization, as opposed to a bad crystallization. Light never crystallizes. That's the recognition that we have to accept. It's not like there's crystallized and uncrystallized states. All states of mind are the same. There are no states of mind, really. There's no crystallization ever happens. Then we think, what kind of crystallized insight can I have about that? But no crystallized insight about it. There's no insight about it. It just is. That is reality. Light knows light. Light is aware of light. Light is aware of light. Say this, even though it doesn't make any sense. Powerful, very powerful. Just say, light is aware of light. Light is aware of light. Light knows light. Light loves light. Light loves light. Inherently so. Because that's all there is. If light wasn't aware of light, there'd be no awareness whatsoever. Right? So, life is light, aware of light. Light loving light. Light knowing light. Light knows light. This is a very good practice. And you will suddenly have a glimpse and get it. You say, oh, that's what it's talking about. Wow. Light knows light. But as we say it, we may not quite understand. What do you mean light knows light? But just practice it. Light knows light. How are we doing here? Okay. Very good. I'm going to try to take this one up to the 4 megabyte and see if it clicks off automatically. I believe it will. Light knows light. Very simple practice. Light loves light. Light is light. Light is light. Light loves light. Light is all light is 100% pure light. Light loves light. So we can do practices directly with light, simple ones, very powerful. Very few people ever get around to this, really. It's not something that even considered, but we're right here, right now, doing this. Light loves light. Light loves light. Light loves light. Now, we talk about going to retreats, going to satsang. Well, right here, this is like online satsang. Retreats about 2.5 hours is pretty common, right? We're doing 2.5 hours here. Don't have to go to Rishikesh for this either. You can do it right in your home, which is very cool. You don't have to take all those shots to go to India, right, and get all sick from the shots. You get worried about dysentery and all this stuff. I mean, we could do it right here. Do the retreat right here. 2.5 hour retreat right here today. Why not? Maybe people just don't get it. They think, oh, what's going on? Well, the intensity is here. We're doing retreats every day. Every day we do a retreat. That's how intense these times are, how important it is. Got to stay on top of it, the situation, or else it will absolutely, we're circling the drain right now. We are circling a drain. We don't want to go down that drain. At all costs, we don't want to go down that drain. So we are very adamant about that. So we're doing a retreat every single day here. And of course, for most people, this is like impossible. No one could do that. So they don't even think it's possible. So they must not be. No, but it is possible. If we realized and saw what is to come here in this world, we would do a retreat every day for sure. So I know what's coming. So I am very motivated to do a retreat every day. Work at it every day. And by doing that, we may, tremendous success. Absolutely, we do. But why delay? Why delay? Delay never leads to anything good. The ego is always trying to get us to go down the drain of endless delay, of total forgetfulness of reality, total disbelief in the Holy Spirit, total disbelief in the lighted realms. Total disbelief. The ego's always trying to reach total disbelief, and it's always cooking up some scheme, a massive scheme for that, always. So delay is never a good option. Curiosity about delay is never a good option. Never. The more we are curious about it, the worse scheme the ego cooks up for us. Pull us down that drain. Get sucked down that dark, slimy drain. We don't want that. We're adamantly opposed to that, adamantly insisting we will not do that. We will not go down the drain. And we're calling on every help possible that's available to us to ensure that we don't. No barriers of time, space, process, and form. No barriers of nature and nature cycles. No barriers of any cycle whatsoever. We're calling upon all help right here, right now, to ensure that we do not go down that drain. And we will take any and all measures necessary so that we do not. So, yeah, retreats are great. All around the world. But retreats every day is even better. That's what we do here. We hit it hard every day. It's like a marathon, but this is what was required. It's a spiritual marathon. But we're spiritual marathoners is what we are here. And we're spiritual marathoners. Most people, like, let's, for instance, if you can't even run at all, you look at marathoners and you're just like, how do they do that? It's unbelievable. I saw this half marathon. I saw these people. I said, I can't believe these people are doing this. They didn't look in that great a shape, but they're still doing it. It was extraordinary. But being a spiritual marathoner, I'm sure most people look at this and say, this is just unbelievable. How is this possible? Well, you get in shape, so how is it possible? It's more important to you than breathing. That's how it's possible. You know what's coming in this world, so that's how it's possible. You got this fire under you. You know, it's lighting a fire. You say, wow. We can't afford to fail here. Failure's not an option. That's how it's possible. I mean, I could be a physical marathoner. I mean, I've never run more than a mile or two in my life, but I could do it. If that was what was called for, I'd be out there every single day, no question about it. I would be determined to do it, and I would do it. But right now, spiritual marathon is more important, way more important. And the others are not important, so don't try to do it all, because that's just foolish. Don't mess with the spiritual marathon. Don't mess with it. Put all your eggs in that basket. We're entering a wet period now here. It's supposed to just be sort of on and off, cold and wet, and it could last for a long time. I don't know. Quite chilly. I've tried to do online in real time Google Meetups or whatever, Google and YouTube has a live streaming function. The software doesn't work. The software doesn't work on my computer. Can't do it. It's been blocked. This is probably more intense anyway. But we'll see. I don't know. No, I don't know what will happen. Just as long as they're doing something this intense, this is fabulous for the few that are availing themselves of this opportunity. It's a huge opportunity. Huge. I mean, we got this big spiritual barbecue going on, and it's, you know, fabulous food here. So only a few people are coming to eat, but yeah, the food's fabulous, no question. Spiritual food. Which is better than physical food, isn't it? Way better. Just like you're taking a run, you're getting towards the end of it, but you say, I'm just going to finish it off. Whatever you're doing, discipline. I mean, I'm not going to cut it short. Let's just, you know, stretch it out a little bit here. Stretch it out. So we're working on stretching this out a little bit. And we will do that. We will see what happens at the 4 gigabyte plateau. If it stops, then that'll be about 2.5 hours, which is a very good retreat time, 2.5 hours. I notice, like, in parallel with working out, I notice I don't get winded now. And running, my breath just stays the same. When I finish the run, I'm not winded at all. Before, I was just like gasping for breath. Now I just, no, my breathing stays the same. Breathing's not all freaked out, struggling. It's not struggling. Same thing with the spiritual path. You get used to retreats, and you don't struggle with them anymore. You realize, I can power through this. I'm not struggling. So at some point in the retreat here, it becomes an issue of just finishing. That's fine. That's part of it. Power through the end of it. Because we're not going to get into any more intensity right now. We've done enough. And yet we're powering through it partly for the wow and partly to build build our toughness, just like an exercise, and we build our fitness. We're just building our fitness here. That becomes easier. The more we power through, the easier it becomes next time. So we're building our spiritual fitness here. So don't worry if your mind is say, "Well, I'm not really thinking about practicing right now." That's fine. We did the intensity. Now we're just building our fitness here and letting the wow smooth out. We're not thinking about what, again, looking, not being curious about what is evaporating. We will, it'll all evaporate. Ultimately, it'll all evaporate. Just won't be there anymore. And there's a really a great camaraderie in those who power through like a retreat 2.5 hours like this. Because they prove to themselves, I can do it. So everyone who did it, they realize, hey, you did it too. I did it, you did it. And there's all this sort of shared respect and camaraderie about doing that. Same thing with a marathon. Why do you think people run marathons? Well, that camaraderie, that respect. Hey, you finished, I finished, wow. You know how tough it is, and they know they finished too. Wow, respect. So it helps kind of camaraderie and respect anytime any people do something that's difficult. That's a good habit, powering through this. And again, we're not showing off. We're not saying, well, we're going to go 8 hours. You know, that's like a marathoner saying, we're going to run a super marathon, double marathon. No, come on. One marathon's enough to have a lot of respect. sometime we could do more, but that 2.5 hours is a power exercise, power workout. If you're doing a power workout, much respect there. Absolutely. Don't let these knuckleheads who try to outsmart themselves bother you. They're just trying to impress the ego. I can guarantee you the ego is more than impressed with this workout. The ego's freaked out about it, saying, whoa, I don't want to deal with these people. It's got the ego on the run, severely on the run. It's got all the fear, continuity fear evaporating. Don't have a story about how the ego's on the run, like where did it run to? We know it's on the run. We don't need to pay attention to where it's running to. It's in some corner cowering. We don't need to pay attention where it's at, where the ego is, what it's doing. We know it's losing its power is what's happening to it. We don't need to narrate all its antics as it loses its power over us. We don't. Don't pay any attention to its antics. We're getting there, 384. See the finish line. Because I didn't check this box. I always check this box. I give at least 4 gigabytes of space. I left it unchecked, so I don't know if it'll just keep on rolling or not. It'd be good to know if we ever need to do longer workouts. There might be some times when we feel especially important that we're gonna, knock out this really long one, very, very intense, and just see how far you can push yourself. But of course, I've already pushed myself. I mean, like, how many hours this morning? 7 hours in bed, plus 2.5 hours here. This is like 9.5, maybe what I did last night, maybe 10 hours for this day already I've done since midnight last night. I've already done 10 in super intense hours. So that's good spiritual fitness right there. Spiritual fitness instructor. Oh wow, we're getting very close to when it usually clicks off. It usually clicks off at 227 something and at 3.91 gigabytes. And so we're getting very close. We're going to find out here soon if it'll end right then. It might. Yeah, these programs have a mind of their own. I can figure them out. You just have to get around them. You just have to get around technology. They're trying to put electronics into everything. I'd like to see electronics get out of everything as much as possible. They want to see how can we put electronics in everything? You know, how much, what more can we put them into? I'd say, hey, let's get electronics out of as much as possible, out of everything as much as possible. I don't think I'm going to fit into the culture going forward, right? No. They're here, make good use of them, but don't keep trying to put them into everything. I prefer just old mechanical stuff, you know, even that. Get that out of everything too, ultimately, but in reality, it doesn't have any electronics in it at all. None. no mechanics either. Just light loving light. Light loves light. Light knows light. Light is light. All light is 100% pure light. All light is 100% pure light. Here we're at the 391. We're at the 391. I went to 392. Interesting. All light loves light. All light is 100% pure light. Now, if you're watching the video and you see there's still some video left, you're smart. You say, oh, well, I know that it went, it kept going. So you got that advantage here. Right here, we don't have the advantage. No, it's in real time here. Don't know how much it will go. But don't outsmart yourself. This is the trouble with smarts. It never gives us what we really want. So then we're driven. It's like an addiction. Smartness is an addiction, actually. It's a terrible addiction. Maybe it's the one of the worst, if not the worst addiction. Smartness. It never satisfies, so we keep outsmarting ourselves. Spend some time not being smart. Just full stop on the wow. No smarts to it. Just pure wisdom. Very important. Now, I'm able to bounce around now like a ballerina. I mean, I'm so nimble, and it seems like now I just like do stuff so fast. It's like, wow, it's like when I was young. I'm so slimmed down, it's easy to move in one direction, go this direction, reach here, reach there. Oh, gotta go over there, real quick. I realize what an advantage slight people have, slight bodies. What an advantage they have, wow. So much easier to move around and do this, and not be tired. These people weigh like 100 pounds, these small people, oh my gosh. It's way easier for them, life is way easier. These big, lumbering, heavy people, those are like drones, slaves. The small, light people enslave everybody, actually. They don't get tired. It's so easy to be nimble and do this and that. They live a long time, too, don't they? It's a little old lady, right? That's the stereotype. It's true. It's true. They weigh 100 pounds their whole life, and less gravity. Working on them. Their mind stays very sharp. But again, the problem of smartness gets to everybody here, doesn't it? Maybe this is the worst addiction of all, smartness. Don't compete with those little old ladies, right? That's a trap. Be just full stop in the wow. You have the permit, my permission for that, and for whatever that's worth, knowing that I have been contacted by these great teachers.